In 2 Timothy chapter 4, let's stand together, please. Chapter 4, verse 6 through 8. For I'm now ready to be offered, and the time of my... What's that next word? You want to tell me, you want me to tell you what another word will fit right in there? I'm going to die. Now, that's what Paul was talking about. When he was saying departure, he wasn't going from San Francisco to New York. He said, I'm getting ready, to use your young folks' language, I'm getting ready to cut out of here. I'm getting ready to cut loose everything that I hold in this life, and I'm going somewhere else. But to get there, I'm going to die. For the time of my departure is at hand. I've fought a good fight. I've finished my course. I've kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Do thy diligently to come shortly unto me. Our Father, help me now, dear Lord, to preach the preaching that you bid me to preach. I don't want to satisfy anybody or make anybody like me. I just want to preach what you want me to preach. Maybe there's a soul here that's not saved. Maybe there's somebody, Lord, that's discouraged. Maybe somebody is walking through an awful valley. And God, you've got the words you want me to say, and I want to say them. And I don't want to say anything you don't want me to say, but I want to say everything you want me to say. I pray this all in Christ's name. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Paul said, I'm now ready. He never said, I'm working. There's a song that said, I'm getting ready. A lot of problems, that song. A lot of problems. This getting ready business, you could come to a place and not be ready. If you're just getting ready, you could miss it. Paul said in the affirmative, I am now ready. I've been traveling on the road for many years. I have to pack a suitcase. I hate it. Oh, Lord God, I hate it. I wore out more suitcases than some of you could ever imagine. And the ones I've got now are getting kind of ragged. And I'm getting ready to try to start taking a few revivals. And that, anyway. Somebody said, did you ever go somewhere to a revival and get there and find out you'd left something at home? I have. That's not good, but I have. So one day I got smart and I said, I better take care of that. So I made me a list. And like the Santa Claus list, I have to check it twice. But I've got over on this side everything that I'll need to take with me. I got my pillow down. I take my pillow where I go. Put it under my arm. My pillow, I don't care what kind of motel it got and how good it is, their pillow's not like my pillow at home. Their bed ain't either, but I have to sleep on it anyhow. So I've got my shirts and my ties and my belts and... my hanky, my toothpaste. Got a list. I check it off. Every time I put something in the suitcase, I check it off. And so when I get that all ready, I said, I'm ready to go. Now I want to ask you the question today as I get ready to open the message. Are you ready? In the event, this could be my last preaching time. I may be preaching my last message. This may be it. I may have opened my Bible the last time. I may have taken my last shower, my last bath. I may have done all of that. But the thing that I've got checked up on this list is not the important thing. That's not it. The thing that Paul was referring to was not a suitcase and what he had in it. The thing that Paul was talking about being ready was that final breath, that final heartbeat, that final function of that human. And suddenly, he knew that body was going to lay still and be quiet because it has what they use a word today, it had expired. It had died. This house you live in right now, right this minute, the Bible talks about Cain and Abel, all those men, Methuselah. And you know what? It comes down to a conclusion, and it said, and they died. The Bible said it's appointed unto man once to die. But then it said the judgment's coming next. Now, my dear friend, if I'm going to leave you with anything this morning, and if I'm going to give you something that I want you to think about, if there's one thing you better know, is that you're going to meet God. That's not a guess so. That's not. You may never meet the president. You may never meet a congressman. You may never meet this man. But I'm going to tell you one thing today. You're going to meet God. Paul said, for we must all appear. You're sitting there right now. Your lungs are inhaling, exhaling, inhaling. Your heart is functioning. Paul said, my time of departure, my time of leaving is at hand. I'm going to have to go. Now, I want to ask you a question. Are you afraid to face eternity? Let me ask it another way. If death should suddenly come and lay his cold hands on your body, and suddenly a pain sweep through your chest, down your arm, and your fingers get numb, and your tongue won't say words, and you know you're dying and going to meet God, what about it? Can you say like Paul, I'm ready. I'm ready. Boy, what a statement. What was Paul saying? I've got my list all checked out. I've checked up. I know where I'm at. You said, now, Preacher Blue, I'm not perfect. Last time I looked over this crowd, none of us are. But the thing that makes me say I know I'm ready is not something I've done, but something He done in here. It's not whether I'm a millionaire or a pauper that made me ready. It's a day on August the 27th, 1935. I got on my knees as a little old boy and gave my heart to Christ. I was born again on August the 27th, 1935. You say, well, now, wait a minute, that's a long time ago. Yeah, but on that happening right there, I can say, I'm ready. Not perfect, not good, but because of Calvary, I'm ready. Well, you said, I got religion. Oh, last time I checked, the devil did too. And he's got you beat. He's got all kinds of it. Religion is not your answer. I hope you don't catch it. If it's contagious, I'll start wearing a mask. I don't want religion. What I'm talking about, that said, let me go. Paul said, for I, who? Me, he said, am now ready. What are you ready for, Paul? He said, I'm going to die. You know what? Some of you are sitting there fooling yourself. You think you ain't going to die. You think you've got it whipped. You've already took a miracle drug, and you've had your appendix took out. But this may come as a shock to you, Turkey. You're going to die. It's appointed unto man once to die. You're going to die. Now, Cain and Abel, that was the first murder. Old brother Adam lived 900 and some years, and the Bible concluded his life by saying, and he died. Here comes along old brother Methuselah, 969 years he lived. Boy, walking along at 900. Do you know, I got to think about that the other day, 969 years. And here I am, 79. I'd be a kid to Methuselah. What about that? Old Methuselah looked down at me and said, how you doing, little boy?
Hey, Uncle.
But you know, the fact is, 969 years, and it concludes by saying, and he died. Brother James and Bobby, they have some association with the funeral home. I don't know whether they get a discount or not, but I heard one undertaker told me, he said, if you walk in, I'll give you a discount. And you know what Bobby and James turned? The first page they turned to in the newspaper is the obituary page. They like it. That keeps him in business. I told James, I said, one of these days, you're going to be in trouble when you read your name in there. I'm not trying just to get you to smile. I'm trying to get you to realize that the most important thing you can do today . It's not whether you're going to get a new car or not, or a new house or not. It's whether you said, when you come down that day, I'm ready. I've got it all taken care of. I've got the list checked out. I've looked inside. I'm born again. I'm under the blood. I'm going. Oh, that's when you can say, I'm ready. In 57 years, I've stood by the bedside of a lot of people. There's been two horrible experiences in my life as I've visited sick people. I've stood by bedsides of cold, clammy hands with somebody squeezing a wet washcloth, a few drops of water, into a dying mouth. Some of you won't like to hear it, but there's a sound that comes. A mouth drops open in the chin, and eyes start rolling back. An old tongue starts wobbling around. And there's a sound that comes out. Honey, before you get there, you better be like Paul can say, I'm ready. Amen. For that is coming. Yes. Or, I remember a lady that I knew, old and sick. Old and sick. I'd go down to her house to visit her, and she couldn't go to church. And that old saint, her kids had shoved her off and treated her like a dog. And I'd go see her, and she said, could you preach for me a little bit? And I said, yeah. And I'd preach up a storm just like a house was full, just me and her in there. And I'd give out, and she'd say, rest a while and preach again. And I preached three times right there one day. And there wasn't even an offering took up. I mean, I preached up a storm. I had a time. And she'd clap her hands and say, oh, glory, glory, glory. But let me tell you how she'd come to the place I'm talking about. One of her kids that needed a knuckle sandwich. Heard her mama was probably dying, and she went down there, and she sat down on that little old bed her mother was dying in, and her mother said, "Oh, honey, don't sit down there." "Why, mama?" Said, "You mean you can't see it, honey?" "See what, mama?" You say, "Well, she was delusional." No, no. She said, "See what, mama?" Said, "Honey, you almost sat down in that big angel's lap." And I come walking in the door about that time, and she said, "Guess what, Brother Blue?" And I said, "What, Granny?" Said, "There's a great big angel standing right there by you." I said, "You're kidding." Do you know what that lady could say? And, you know, there was a... one of her favorite songs was, me and her sang it, oh, we'd sing it for everybody. She would sing, "My strongest trials now are past. My race is almost run." Woo! That day as I stood there by that saint of God, she could say, if anybody I ever met could say, "I'm ready." I don't care what kind of house you live in. That don't impress me a cotton picking bit. I don't care what kind of car you drive. Hooey on that. I don't care if that suit costs $10,000 or like mine, the cut rate. The thing that you better get your mind and your marbles together about is whether you can say, "I'm ready." If you slept in a cardboard box last night in the alley, that was not one thing that impressed or didn't impress God. You know what? God's looking down on you this morning and sees whether you have been to Calvary or not. That's all that makes any difference. When I leave here, and I'm going to leave, thank God, I've already passed through the Hutmobile and the Terraplane Age. If you don't know what that is, that used to be cars. I passed through the horse and the buggy day and the turning plow age and all of that. I've come through the throwaway razor age. I remember when a sweet gum bush and a limb off of it was a toothbrush. I passed through that. I've passed through the Brogan age. How many of you know what Brogans are? You young turkeys, that's shoes. I passed through the barefoot age. And I've got broke toes to prove it. I've been through all of that. But the thing that's marked down on the calendar of my life is this. August the 27th, 1935. Because of that, I can say, I'm now ready. Better than Bill Clinton done. What makes you so sure of your readiness? What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. I've been to Calvary. My name has been written down. Hallelujah. The rejoicing of all rejoicing comes to me today. that I can know without a shadow of a doubt my sins are gone. Amen, Brother Staten? Gone. Oh, you said you're a sinner. Oh, yes. But the sin of Adam, the sin of my transgression, the sin of my life, one day at Calvary, I confessed my sins, and He forgave them, past, present, and future. Now, my assurance of being ready is not because I'm perfect. I would not have you to misunderstand me. I'm not. I cannot say that. I lay no claim to perfection. Someone said, what is your hope anchored in? My hope is anchored in the shed blood of Calvary.
Amen.
On Christ, that solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. In my hand, no price I bring, but simply to the cross I cling. Now, I'm going to tell you something, and you better listen to me, and you can go ahead and laugh and make fun if you want to. But the Holy Spirit just whispered to my heart, somebody here today is getting awful close to a dangerous hour. You're putting it off and putting it off and putting it off and putting it off. You've got it covered up. You're hid. You think everybody don't know, and they don't, may not know. But the Holy Spirit just whispered to my heart and said, somebody here today better get ready. Now, you think I'm lying? No. I'd stop to tell you that. Some of you right now, you might even stick your hand up and say, I am. But all the time, you know, it's counterfeit. You know what gives me a great big old leap in my soul? I can say, I'm now ready. Bible said, be ye therefore ready, for in such an hour as you think not,
amen,
the Son of Man cometh.
Amen.
See, if there's one thing, listen, I don't want to lay down at night, oh God, and close my eyes. My wife, family, they all have a heart problem, a certain kind. They just go to, like Edna, Harv, laid down and just closed his eyes, never to wake up. They go to sleep, and just, that's going first class, boy. If you can say, I'm ready. But can you imagine going to sleep one night feeling pretty good and not wake up and not be ready? See, I've just read to you one of the most... Listen, Paul said, the time of my departure at hand. He said, I've fought a good fight. I've kept the faith. I've finished my course. But the thing that puts this all together was when he said, I'm ready. Not going to get ready. I'm ready now. I'm ready now. Here it is. 11:45. 15 minutes. I'll be through by then, by even less. You've come here today not to just see me, but God in His sovereign plan has brought you here. Oh, you said, somebody begged me to come and I decided to go. Well, you may think that, and that's what you, but God in His mercy and love allowed you to come. Why? He knows what I'm going to preach. He gave it to me. He told me what to preach. And He knew you was going to be here, and He knows some, that's what He whispered to me a while ago, said, somebody here lost. And the thing about He knows who it is, and you do too. Oh, you're trying to shove it back. Nothing. He's not talking to me. Uh-huh, I am too. Oh, Preacher Blue, you're not. Yeah, I'm talking to you. Yeah. Your hands are clammy and sweaty. And you said, oh, he's not. Yeah, I'm talking to you. You're it. You ever have that team, you know, when you're playing as a kid? Peg, you're it. Hey, you're it.
Amen.
Well, you said, hey, everybody thinks I'm all right. God, and you know you're not all right. You know who you is. I was preaching one night, and the preacher, I saw a lot of preachers get saved. A lot of them need to get saved. Look at the statement again. Paul said, I'm ready. Can you say that same thing? If in the next 15 minutes, God said, your appointment's up. Time to go. Time to leave. You won't have time to say goodbye to your family. Here sits a mother caring for her child. What if suddenly the bottle that she has pressed to its mouth, her hand should drop that bottle? She wouldn't have time to kiss the little one over there, or the one there, or go to her husband there. He said, oh, you're imagining things. Now, you're trying to scare me. No, I'm trying to get you to face reality. I'm trying to get you to see death can come so suddenly. Paul said, I'm now. When, Paul? Now. Say that with me. Now. Say it again. Now. Are you ready now? It's quiet in here, isn't it? It's not that you just want to get home. You're trying to get out from under this message. You want to run, don't you? You want to run outside and light up a cigarette so you calm your nerves. Honey, this message is going to go home with you.
Amen.
This message will go to work with you tomorrow. For I am now ready. Peggy, come to the piano. Come on, honey, get your song ready. You know, I'm just walking around up here, and so help me God, I know there's somebody right now trembling all over. Soon you're going to face God. Soon you're going to meet God. You're going to meet God. You're not going to meet some congressman. Hey, turkey, you're going to meet the Creator. The I Am. The Sovereign. The Eternal One. And without Him was not anything made that was made. You're going to meet the Creator.
Amen.
Softly. Softly. Scary time right now. You're trying, and if you don't watch out, a baby will cry or something, try to get you out of here. Somebody's lost. And if you think I'm going to try to get you up here just to cry a few tears and make yourself feel better, you're crazy. If you better do one thing, you better get on your knees and get down to business. And then when you come up from there, you better be able to say, I'm ready. Every head bowed. Now, boys and girls, you better listen to me. Somebody's in trouble. I'm not trying to make you doubt. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm trying to get you to face a fact. You better get ready. I'm going to ask a question. You better listen to me, and you watch out or you'll lie. Somebody will lie. I want to see the hands of everyone that can say right now, and boy, don't you tell a story. How many of you right now can raise your hand and say, I can say along with Paul, because of Calvary, I'm ready. I want to see you raise your hand. Take them down. Now, you don't know who it was, and I'm not going to tell you. But there's people in here who couldn't raise their hands. And that's so scary. That is so scary. That is so scary. But I wonder how many right now that could not raise your hand, and you're not ready, and you're not right with God, you wouldn't want to die like this. I wonder how many of you that could not raise your hand will raise your hand right now and say, "Preacher, please pray for me. I'm lost. I don't know the Lord." Yes, I see that hand back there. Thank you, sir. You can take it down. Wonder if there's another hand right now to go up and say, "Preacher, pray for me. I'm not right with God. I don't want to die like this." Raise your hand. I'm going to wait because there's somebody here. There's more than that one person. I know there is. God said there was. There's somebody else who needs to raise that hand. I ain't going to give you no fast relief. Somebody here's in bad shape. Would you just slip up your hand and say, "Pray for me"? I ain't going to come back to you and embarrass you. I ain't going to do that. Father, Lord, there's a one man raised his hand. Said, "I'm not ready, not right." I pray for that man today. May this be the good hour that he'll get right with God. May this be the good time that he'll get on his knees and say, "Lord, I'm not ready, but I want to. When I leave this altar, I want to be ready. I don't want a quick fix. I want my heart to be right with God." Others need to come today. Backsliders. Oh, God, you know who's here. You know everyone that needs to make a move for Christ's sake. Amen. Let's stand together. If you're here today and you need to come to this altar and get right with God, now is your time to do it. Sing it now.
Just
one of the smoothest tricks the devil plays on people at a time like this is a trick of procrastination. I'll do it later. Not right now, but later. And there's somebody right now, the devil's already sold you on that bill of goods this morning. I'll do it later. There may not be a later. This may be, as I said at the outset, this may be the last message I'll preach. This may be the last message you'll hear. This may be the last altar call you'll ever be given. One more song right now, one more verse.
Just
I want you to be back tonight. I have a message that God's already given my heart. I want you to be here. I want you to come. Plan to come. It's a message that I feel like we all need. Not just you, but me. All of us need. It's applicable to our hearts and our lives. Be back tonight at 6 o'clock. Thank you for coming. Now listen to me. Just because those doors back there will be open in a few minutes and you can leave, that doesn't mean that the message that God sent to you is going to leave you. As a young preacher, it used to worry me, and it still does to an extent, when folks would not come. But it's not my job to make you come. And I'm thankful for that. But my job is to deliver the goods, and then what you do with them is up to you. Brother Bobby, it's all yours.